I think, I can't speak for most Protestants, but I think at some point the protest needs to end. When will that be? Most assuredly not in my lifetime. How did the protest begin? Well, read the story of... The fact is, there were multiple protests before Luther. And your point about Protestantism and its continual fracturing is an important one, one not lost on Protestants. There's an element of Protestantism that is unstable. But I think Protestantism has played an important part in the continual reformation and purification of the church. I don't remember who it was that I read, but it's not a unique opinion that in some ways Martin Luther was one of the most important reformers of the Roman Catholic Church that has ever been. Now, Martin Luther, with nailing his 95 theses, very much as an obedient son of the church, wanted to reform the church. I want the protest to end because I want Jesus, and I expect to be a Protestant until the day I die. I want the protest to end because I want Jesus' prayer in the Gospel of John to be fulfilled. And I will, that we will all be one, that we will all be one, that we will all be one. The Father and the Son are one. The Father and the Son are one. He wrote the 95 theses in Latin. He did it in a way that was basically the normal practice to begin a theological disputation. And he wrote that disputation to engage in a theological conversation with those who understood Latin and could engage about some practices in the church that were, that he found abhorrent. He was looking to reform the church. Well, what happened? Well, some of his students translated, the printing press got involved, some of the students translated the Latin into German, and the warm water of the Holy Roman Empire and some other places in the European Roman Catholic Church at that point was sufficient to encourage and fuel a storm that continues to rage. I want the protest to end because I want Jesus, and I expect to be a Protestant until the day I die. I want the protest to end because I want Jesus' prayer in the Gospel of John to be fulfilled. And I will, that we will all be one, that we will all be one, that we will all be one. The Father and the Son are one. The Father and the Son are one. Storms of this kind last centuries. That's not unusual in Christian history. Look at how long the Arian movement lasted. Look at how long the Donatist dispute lasted. Rebellion and darkness have their role to play in consummation and light. Look at the name of Protestantism. It's a protest. I want the protest to end because I want Jesus, and I expect to be a Protestant until the day I die. I want the protest to end because I want Jesus' prayer in the Gospel of John to be fulfilled. Protestantism has had its part to play, and we can critique those parts, and we can, and there are, just like I said before, in this process of reformation, there's always gain and there's always loss. And I think what Protestantism best looks for is the end of the protest. And you know, I wonder sisters, that we will all be one. Romans 9 through 11. To what degree, you know, we're not waiting for a further unification. Of course, as Christian, I say under Christ. Father and the Son are one. Of course, as Christian, I say under Christ. But I got to be careful that we will all be one. History of that we will all be real one. Sinful behavior. Some of those things. The Father and the Son are one. What we're really getting into here is the one and the many. And I think it's a sign of the movement of God's Spirit that the various here in the globalization, which has some real issues of its own, in some ways the church, the different separated portions of the church have to look at each other and work their stuff out.